بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In this lecture, we will talk about the autonomic nervous system. This system is very important from the medical point of view. Since the autonomic nervous system is responsible for regulation of all the activity of the visceral and the internal organ. Accordingly, if there is disturbance in any organ, it might be related to the disturbance in the function of the autonomic nervous system. Moreover, in the treatment of many diseases, we should manipulate the function of the autonomic nervous system. That is to say, to increase or decrease the autonomic function, accordingly, we may treat many symptoms that may affect the patient during disease. So that you should know a lot about the autonomic nervous system in order to be able to deal with medical problems. The nervous system can be classified into two groups, the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. The central nervous system is present in the skull and the spinal canal, and it is formed of the brain, including the subcortex, the cerebellum, and brainstem. Also, we have the other part in the spinal cord. While the peripheral nervous system, it represents all the nerve fiber that are present all over the body. These peripheral nerve fiber can be divided into two groups: somatic part or somatic nerve fiber and autonomic nerve fiber. The somatic nerve fiber includes the nerve fiber that supply the sense organ and the voluntary skeletal muscle, while the autonomic nerve fiber are responsible for supplying the internal organ and the gland. Accordingly, the somatic nervous system can be divided into sensory part and motor part. The sensory part represents the nerve fiber that carry the information from the periphery of the body to the central nervous system, while the motor nerve fiber carry the impulses from the central nervous system to the skeletal muscle to perform action. On the other hand, the autonomic nervous system is divided into two divisions, the sympathetic division and the parasympathetic division. The sympathetic division, in general, it is regarded as the arousal part of the autonomic nervous system, while the parasympathetic division represents the calming part of the autonomic nervous system. To define the autonomic nervous system, the autonomic nervous system is the involuntary part of the nervous system. It supplies all the internal organ or viscera of the body, like the cardiovascular system, the respiratory system, GI tract, urinary system, genital system, and glands. So, all the organ inside the body are or should be supplied by autonomic nerve fiber. But you know that these organs, whether the cardiovascular, respiratory, GI tract, or any organ inside the body, have an innate property that keeps them functioning all the time, automatically. Then, what is the function of this autonomic nervous system? It is responsible for regulation of the activity of these systems, or viscera, or organs. Which means that, for example, in the cardiovascular system, we have the heart. If we do exercise, we should increase the heart rate and cardiac output. And this can be done by stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system. While if there is increase in the exercise, we should increase the respiration, and so it occurs by change in the autonomic. Then, the autonomic nervous system will regulate the system according to the need of the body in different states. Anatomically, this autonomic nervous system can be divided into central part and peripheral part. In more detail, the autonomic nervous system can be divided into higher center, autonomic ganglia, and autonomic nerve fiber. The higher centers means collection of nerve cells within the central nervous system. So there are collection of cells which are related to the autonomic nervous system in the cerebral cortex, in the hypothalamus, in the brainstem. They are representing centers for regulation of the autonomic nervous system and so regulation of the different organs inside the body. The other group or the other part of the autonomic nervous system is the autonomic ganglia. Ganglia means collection of nerve cells outside the central nervous system, like for example in the body, in the abdomen, on the heart, on the stomach, there is collection of nerve cells. These are called autonomic ganglia. Next we have the autonomic nerve fiber, and they are distributed all over the body, all over the internal organ, and even in the skin, on the gland, like for example sweat gland, and they are responsible for regulation of the effector organ. These peripheral nerves are going out from the central nervous system. Since we said that there are centers of autonomic nervous system within the spinal cord and the central nervous system, and from these centers impulses are going out to the different organs in the body, so that we have what is called as outflow. These outflow or nerve fiber, autonomic nerve fiber, can be divided into cranial outflow, thoracolumbar outflow, and sacral outflow. The cranial outflow represent four cranial nerves that carry autonomic nerve fiber, which are the oculomotor, the facial, the glossopharyngeal, and the vagus nerve, while the rest of the cranial nerve does not have autonomic nerve fiber. The second group of autonomic nerve fiber is the thoracolumbar outflow. From its name, thoracolumbar outflow, it means that it is going out from the thoracic and lumbar segment. It includes all the thoracic segment from T1 to T12 and the upper two lumbar segments, lumbar 1 and lumbar 2. The third outflow is the sacral outflow, which includes the upper three segment of the sacral part of the spinal cord. These are sacral 2, sacral 3, and maybe sacral 4. If we look on the function of these outflow, the cranial outflow and the sacral outflow, the cranial outflow and the sacral outflow have a similar function, and their function is regarded as the parasympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system. On the other hand, the sympathetic division represented by the thoracolumbar outflow. So we have two divisions, the parasympathetic division, which includes the cranial outflow and the sacral outflow, and we have the thoracolumbar outflow, which is representing the sympathetic nervous system. The innervation of the body with autonomic nerve fiber. Most of the tissue that we have, they contain both sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve fiber. But there are some organ does not have either sympathetic or parasympathetic nervous system. In most cases, the sympathetic nervous system have an opposite function to that of the parasympathetic nervous system. So, in normal condition, or the normal rate of function of the different organ represent a state of equilibrium between the effect of the sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. We said that most of the organ does receive parasympathetic and sympathetic, but there are some organs which receive only sympathetic or only parasympathetic. For example, the vagus nerve, the oesophagus, receive only parasympathetic nerve fiber through the vagus nerve. This oesophagus tissue does not have sympathetic nerve supply. On the other hand, or on the opposite side, the uterus does contain sympathetic nerve supply but does not have parasympathetic nerve fiber. This information should be known by any doctor, because if you want to change the function of the uterus, you should not give anything related to the cholinergic system or the parasympathetic nervous system, but because there is no parasympathetic nerve fiber. While, for example, the GI tract does contain parasympathetic nervous system. Let me explain it in another way. For example, anyone who gets abdominal colic, it might be due to increase in the parasympathetic nervous system. So, to treat such patient, we give drug which block the parasympathetic. If there is increase in the contraction of the uterus, as it is happened in dysmenorrhea, which is the pain during menstrual cycle, we cannot block the parasympathetic to improve this condition because there are no parasympathetic nerve fiber in the uterus. In addition to that, in most of the cases, the parasympathetic is opposite to that, the sympathetic effect. But in certain conditions, the sympathetic effect may have the similar function to the parasympathetic nervous system. Like, for example, on the blood vessel, the effect of acetylcholine produces vasodilation and also the stimulation of beta receptor by sympathetic stimulation may lead to vasodilation. So, both of them, the sympathetic and parasympathetic, will produce same function in certain organs. The organs that contain only sympathetic nerve fiber include the pilomotor, the spleen capsule, the adrenal medulla, adipose tissue, hepatic cell, and sweat gland. If we do sympathetic stimulation, it will produce erection of the hair by pilomotor muscle and contraction of the spleen to increase the blood inside the cardiovascular system. Stimulation of the adrenal medulla causes secretion of the adrenaline. Stimulation of the adipose tissue by sympathetic stimulation will produce an increase in energy and heat. Stimulation of the hepatic cell will produce an increase in the glucose level by glycogenesis and gluconeogenesis. And the stimulation of the sweat gland will produce increase the sweating by sympathetic stimulation. As we said, we have centers within the central nervous system related to the autonomic nervous system, and we have ganglia. Ganglia, as we said, it is a collection of nerve cells present outside the central nervous system. These ganglia are of three types: paravertebral ganglia, peripheral ganglia, and collateral ganglia. Paravertebral, these are the paravertebral ganglia. Peripheral, which is present as the aorta, and the intermediate or collateral ganglia is present between the two. To start with, the paravertebral ganglia, these ganglia are present near the vertebral column. so that they have short preganglionic nerve fiber because the ganglia is present near the spinal cord. But the postganglionic nerve fiber, the fiber which is going out of the ganglia to supply the organ, will be very long, and sometimes it is divided into many branches, so that the stimulation of these ganglia will produce a diffuse effect because it will be distributed into many organ or many tissue. So they have diffuse function. Most of the paravertebral ganglia are sympathetic nerve function. The other type of ganglia is the peripheral ganglia, and they are present on the organ or near the organ, like for example on the heart, on the stomach, on the bladder. These ganglia are present away from the spinal cord, so that they have long preganglionic nerve fiber starting from the spinal cord and ending at the organ. But the postganglionic nerve fiber is short and they are not branching, so their effect will be localized at that organ, localized for example on the stomach, localized on the heart, or on the bladder. Most of these peripheral ganglia or terminal ganglia are parasympathetic function. The third type of ganglia is the collateral. We said that it is present in between the paravertebral and the terminal ganglia. They are intermediate, which means intermediate in position, so they have neither short nor long preganglionic, neither short nor long prolonged postganglionic. Also, their function is also intermediate, neither diffused to many organs nor localized to one single organ. So all their activity and all their structure is intermediate between the paravertebral and the terminal ganglia. And more, these ganglia, some of them are related to the sympathetic nervous system, some other are related to the parasympathetic nervous system. One of the gland, which is the adrenal medulla, the medulla of the adrenal gland. The adrenal gland is a gland present above the kidney, so it is called as suprarenal gland. The medulla of this gland is embryologically and functionally related to the autonomic nervous system, because these ganglia, these gland here, adrenal medulla, receive a preganglionic nerve fiber from the autonomic nervous system, but they do not have postganglionic nerve fiber. Instead, once we stimulate the preganglionic nerve fiber, the adrenal medulla will secrete adrenaline and noradrenaline. You know that the adrenaline and noradrenaline have a similar function to the autonomic nerve, to the sympathetic nerve fiber, so that the adrenal gland is regarded as a part of the autonomic nervous system because they have a similar function to the sympathetic nervous system. As you know, the nerve fiber produce their effect through chemical transmitter. These chemical transmitter or neurotransmitter are of two types in the autonomic nervous system. These are the acetylcholine and noradrenaline or adrenaline. The acetylcholine is released by all the preganglionic nerve fibers, whether they are sympathetic or parasympathetic. So the neurotransmitter at the ganglia is acetylcholine, whether this ganglia is sympathetic or parasympathetic ganglia. Acetylcholine is also the neurotransmitter in all the postganglionic nerve fiber. The postganglionic nerve fiber release acetylcholine at the effector organ. Some of the postganglionic sympathetic fiber, like the sympathetic fiber to the sweat gland and to the blood vessel of skeletal muscle, although they are sympathetic, but their neurotransmitter is also acetylcholine. Another site where we have acetylcholine as neurotransmitter is the neuromuscular junction, and also it is the neurotransmitter in certain part of the nervous system, central nervous system, and it have a direct effect on the blood vessel. So that acetylcholine is present in all the ganglia, sympathetic and parasympathetic, present at the postganglionic parasympathetic, present at some sympathetic postganglionic nerve fiber, at the neuromuscular junction, central nervous system, and they have direct effect. As you see here, this is the cranial and sacral outflow. They are parasympathetic nerve fiber. So their preganglionic nerve fiber secrete acetylcholine, and their postganglionic nerve fiber secrete acetylcholine. While the thoracolumbar segment have preganglionic, which is secrete acetylcholine, but the postganglionic secrete noradrenaline. In the thoracic segment, the nerve fiber, preganglionic nerve fiber, which go to the adrenal medulla, would secrete acetylcholine. And the adrenal medulla would secrete adrenaline and noradrenaline as neurotransmitter. The effect of this neurotransmitter, who is acetylcholine, which is related to the parasympathetic nervous system. The effect of acetylcholine, we said that acetylcholine is released at the ganglia and at the effector organ. But the acetylcholine at the ganglia is acting on receptor which is different from the receptor which is present at the effector organ. The acetylcholine at the ganglia which will act on certain receptor called nicotinic receptor. And they have similar action to nicotine. They can be blocked by ganglionic blocking agent, like for example hexomethonium. While the receptor, which is present at the effector organ, not in the ganglia, they are called muscarinic receptor, and they are stimulated by muscarin and can be blocked by atropine. This difference in the effect of acetylcholine at the ganglia and the tissue is very important, because the ganglia, sympathetic or parasympathetic, release acetylcholine. So if we give ganglionic blocking agent, like for example hexamethonium, it will block the sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve fiber. While if we give atropine, which blocks the muscarinic receptor, we are blocking only the parasympathetic nerve fiber. So we can manipulate or change the function of the autonomic nervous system by the effect on acetylcholine receptor at the ganglia and the effector organ. These muscarinic receptors are of different types, M1, M2, M3, M4, M5. Each one of them is present specifically in certain organs. Like for example, M1 is present in the subcortex, M2 in the heart, M3 in the smooth muscle, M4 in the basal ganglia, M5 in other parts of the brain like the substantia nigra. All of these receptors are activated by acetylcholine, but each one of them will have certain function, because each organ has a specific type of these receptors. Accordingly, there are different functions of the acetylcholine in different organs of the body according to the availability of certain receptors. After doing its effect, acetylcholine should be removed in order to get the resting condition. And this can be done by choline esterase. This choline esterase will destroy the acetylcholine and convert into acetyl and choline. So we will get loss of the function. Later on, there will be reuptake of these chemical substances and resynthesis of acetylcholine and release again as a site of function. If there is leakage of some of acetylcholine from the site of action to the blood, it should be removed, and the removal occurs by the acetylcholine esterase, which is less efficient than acetylcholine esterase, but it is sufficient to remove the effect of acetylcholine from the periphery. One of the conditions that we mentioned it in the previous lecture is myasthenia gravis. This is characterized by weakness in the muscles, tiredness, fatigability, and this is due to decrease in the acetylcholine. It occurs at any age, and it may be related to autoimmune disease. This autoimmune disease will produce either reduction in the acetylcholine or reduction in the receptor, or sometimes the receptor are normal, the concentration of acetylcholine are normal, but these receptors are covered with the protein, render them to inactive receptors, so we will get such condition, clinical condition, myasthenia gravis, weakness of the muscle. The other neurotransmitter, neurotransmitters are of two types, acetylcholine and noradrenaline. Noradrenaline substance have the ability to produce effect in most of the postganglionic parasympathetic nerve fiber and in the adrenal medulla. So noradrenaline is released from the postganglionic sympathetic and from the adrenal medulla, and also it may be released from certain cells in the central nervous system. Even noradrenaline, neurotransmitter, in most of the postganglionic sympathetic, in adrenal medulla, and in the central nervous system. This noradrenaline is synthesized inside the body from amino acid, which is phenylalanine, converted into tyrosine, then dopamine, then DOPA and dopamine and norepinephrine, in order to do its function. The effect of nerve fiber, which is released adrenaline and noradrenaline, which are called as adrenergic nerve fiber, depend on the type of receptor which is present in that tissue. Like that of the muscarinic receptor, different type of muscarinic receptor. In the sympathetic nervous system, we have different type of adrenergic receptor. These are alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3. The effect of alpha 1 will produce contraction of the smooth muscle. The effect of alpha 2 will produce inhibition of noradrenaline release and the relaxation of the muscle. Beta 1 will produce stimulation of adrenal cyclase and cardiac excitation. Beta 2 stimulate adrenal cyclase and produce relaxation of the smooth muscle. Beta 3 is present in the adipose tissue, so it is thermogenic substance. So that the variation in the action of the adrenergic nerve fiber depends on the availability and the type of the receptor which is present in the tissue. For example, the blood vessel contain receptor, alpha 1 receptor, and also contain alpha beta 2 receptor. So that if we give noradrenaline or adrenaline. This will act on alpha 1 receptor, produce stimulation, and this stimulation will produce contraction of the blood vessel, while beta 2, which is also stimulated by the adrenergic receptor, it will produce vasodilation. Then, adrenergic stimulation can produce vasoconstriction or vasodilation, or both vasoconstriction and vasodilation. And in some tissue, this adrenaline can produce only vasoconstriction if they have only alpha 1 receptor. And in another tissue, the sympathetic stimulation produces vasodilation by sympathetic stimulation due to the presence of beta 2 receptor. For example, during exercise, there will be vasodilation of the blood vessels and the skeletal muscle. But at the same time, there will be vasoconstriction in the blood vessel of the intestine because they have alpha 1 receptor rather than beta 2 receptor. So that the beta receptor are of three types, beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3. Beta 1 is present in the heart and they are responsible for increasing the rate, conduction and contraction of the heart, so it will produce increase in the cardiac output. Also, beta 1 may be present in the salivary gland, produce salivation, in the urinary system, produce increase in renin-angiotensin system, and increase in the relaxation of the bladder, also present in the central nervous system. The other type of beta receptor here, beta 2 receptor, and they are present in the respiratory passages like the bronchus, and they are responsible for vasodilation or dilatation or relaxation of the smooth muscle of bronchus, so that during asthma we make our bronchiolitis, which is spasm in the smooth muscle of the bronchus and bronchiole, we give adrenaline that produce dilatation of these smooth muscles. Bladder is also affected by beta 2 receptor, produce relaxation of the bladder. Uterus is also affected by beta 2, but this is not through nerve fiber, it is through the adrenaline and noradrenaline through the blood supply. The third type of receptor is beta 3. And they are present in the adipose tissue, in the central nervous system, and in the urinary bladder. In the urinary bladder, it produces relaxation. Central nervous system, it produces opposite to the stress. So it produces calming, lipolysis, and thermogenesis in the adipose tissue. The adrenergic receptor, in addition to beta receptor, we have alpha receptor, which is of two types, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Alpha 1 produce contraction of the smooth muscle, and they are present in the sphincter, like the bladder of the sphincter. So, stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system will produce a relaxation of the wall of the bladder by beta receptor, and contraction of the sphincter by alpha 1, so that it will accommodate more urine without urination. On the other hand, alpha 2 receptor is present in the proper smooth muscle and they are responsible for relaxation instead of contraction. So that overstimulation of alpha 2 receptor in the intestine produces paralysis of the intestine. Noradrenaline can act on alpha and beta receptor. So that if we give noradrenaline, it will produce in small concentration, it will produce alpha stimulation and so produce vasoconstriction. If we are increasing the concentration of the noradrenaline, it will act on the beta more than alpha, because beta receptor, although it is less sensitive to noradrenaline, but it is more potent So we will get dilatation of blood vessel, and this will cause increase in blood supply. These adrenergic receptors, alpha and beta, according to their availability, it will produce different function in the body. For example, tissue which have both alpha and beta receptors, like smooth muscle of the blood vessel, smooth muscle of blood vessel, can produce vasodilation and vasoconstriction. But the tissue which contain only beta receptors, like that of the iris, it will produce only relaxation. So there will be dilatation of the pupil and what is called as mydriasis. The intestinal sphincter contain only alpha 1 receptor, so that if we give noradrenaline, it will produce contraction of the sphincter, so that the effect of noradrenaline in the different tissue vary according to the type of receptor. The effect of adrenaline also depend on the type of receptor, whether it is alpha or beta, to get vasoconstriction, vasodilatation, contraction of the smooth muscle, or relaxation of the smooth muscle. The last or the most important thing about the function of the autonomic nervous system. We said that the autonomic nervous system is not voluntary, it is involuntary. Then how can we change the activity of the body according to the changing the autonomic nerve stimulation? Generally speaking, the activity of the autonomic nervous system depends on reflex arc or reflex activities. We said that the reflex arc will produce change in the autonomic function. Like, for example, if someone go to a hot place, so the thermoreceptor will be stimulated, and they will send their impulses through the sensory nerve fiber to the autonomic neuron present on the lateral horn of the spinal cord. This is the dorsal horn, ventral horn, and this is the lateral horn. It will send the impulses to the lateral horn, from which motor nerve fiber, effector nerve fiber, will be sent to the sweat gland, and this will produce sweating. On the other hand, if there is cold temperature, it will send the impulses to the autonomic neuron, and from these autonomic nerve fiber, impulses will go to the intestine, and it may lead to cavity abdominal contraction. Accordingly, the function of the autonomic nervous system and changing the activity of the body depending on reflex activity or reflex arc. This reflex arc is also present in the somatic nervous system, as we mentioned in the previous lecture. If you remember my example, if you put your hand on a table and there is a pen in that table, or that table contains hot plate, then the high temperature or the pain sensation will produce a reflex contraction of the hand, and you will pull your hand upward. So in the somatic nervous system we have reflex arc, and in the autonomic nervous system we have reflex arc. But there is differences between the reflex arc of the somatic nervous system and that of the autonomic nervous system. These differences, some of them are anatomical and some other are functional or physiological. The anatomical difference is that in the autonomic reflex arc, not the somatic reflex arc, in the autonomic nerve reflex arc, the nerve fiber, the sensory nerve fiber, instead of ending at the dorsal horn like that of the somatic reflex arc, it will end on the lateral horn, as I said a moment ago. While in the somatic, the sensory nerve fiber will end at the dorsal horn. This is the first difference. The sensory nerve fiber, the afferent nerve fiber, will end not on the dorsal root horn of the spinal cord, it will end on the lateral horn of the spinal cord. The other difference, the MV somatic reflex arc, since the sensory nerve fiber and in the dorsal horn, from the dorsal horn we have the interconnecting neuron which will go to the ventral horn, and from the ventral horn the impulse will go to the skeletal muscle. In the autonomic nervous system, as the sensory nerve fiber and at the lateral horn, so the interconnecting neuron is present at the lateral horn, and this interconnecting neuron will send its action towards the autonomic ganglia. And from the autonomic ganglia, we have the third neuron, the reward motor neuron. So that in the autonomic reflex arc, the interconnecting neuron is present in the lateral horn instead of the dorsal horn, and it is sent there, its action outside the central nervous system to the ganglia. The third anatomical difference in the motor neuron. In the somatic reflex arc, the motor neuron is present at the ventral horn, while in the autonomic reflex arc, the motor neuron may be present at the autonomic ganglia and into the effector organ. Even these are the three differences in the sensory nerve fiber, in the interconnecting neuron, and in the motor nerve fiber between the autonomic reflex arc and the somatic reflex arc. In regard to the physiological difference, always when we do stimulation of the sensory nerve fiber, for the skeletal muscle, always it produces contraction, because excitation to the skeletal muscle always produces contraction. While in the autonomic reflex arc, if we do stimulation of the sensory nerve fiber, it will produce either contraction of the smooth muscle or relaxation of the smooth muscle. So it will produce either excitatory or inhibitory effect, not like that of the somatic reflex arc.